teaches is mainly in mindset. She teaches a lot of courses in mindset in her university. By the way, let me show you. Okay, can you see a picture of the website or our school website?
No, you can,
you can see the left hand side, the Fang Shucheng. He's the supervisor of Professor Hu. Fang Shucheng, he is the honor professor in our department. He's also very active in the Faisei. Okay, let's welcome Professor Hu. Okay. 那我们现在欢迎吴老师来演讲。你可以开始哦。Okay,
thank you, Professor Ye.
好, you're welcome.
Okay, hello, everyone. Good evening. My name is Chen Fang Hu. I'm from National Jiayi University. Glad to be here and spend the evening with you. Today, I'm going to introduce you the Faisei theory and its application in industrial engineering.
老师，叶老师要取消共用。
所以，然后换胡老师的荧幕。所以，我刚刚讲的话，你们听得到吗？
Yes, I can hear you.
那其他同学应该也可以哈。
No problem.
Yes.
Okay, thank you. 一竹, let me know if I can start it.
Oh, that's okay. And you can show your slides.
So can you see my topic, Faisei theory and its application now?
Not yet.
看不到吗?
还没，老师你再重用一次好了。我要重用哈，好，等我一下哦。那我现在是就把我的PPT放到，就是开。
现在这样呢？还是看不到吗？还没。喂，还是我退出再进来吗？因为我就是我已经把那个整个播放在我的荧幕上了。诶，其他人有看到吗？没有。吴老师，你有几个荧幕啊？没有看到。大家都没有看到。诶，那老师有按共享吗？中间那个。
老师有按分享吗？等一下哦。好，我在分享吗？分享在哪边啊？我就看到麦克风的第一旁边有个分享。
分享是吗？好，我先按分享，然后。 等我一下哦。 这样有看到吗？ 这样有看到吗？
嗯，没有。
我按分享啦。
然后那有选到萤幕吗？ 分享之后它有个萤幕画面分享。
对对对对。
点整个画面吗？可以，或是应用程式视窗。哦，对对对，应用程式视窗，我想起来了。好，点它。好，嗯，OK，分享到投影片。这样子呢？有看到了，成功了。可以哈。可以。好，那我再从这页开始喽。好，可以哈。
Okay, today I'm going to introduce you the Faisei theory and its application in industrial engineering. I'm very glad to be here and spend the evening with you. I hope you enjoyed today's lecture. At first, I would like to introduce myself. I was a student of National Tsinghua University 30 years ago. I got my PhD degree in the United States. At North Carolina State University Operation Research Program. 我是1993年毕业于清华大学数学系的学姐。然后 在1997年的时候毕业于美国北卡罗来纳州立大学的 Operation Research Program 最研究的这个研究所，然后回台湾开始教书到现在，那目前任教于嘉义大学应用数学系，欢迎大家有空到嘉义来找我。那下面这个是我的 email 住址，所以可以有问题的话都可以写 email 跟我讨论。好，那 let's start our lecture today. Today I'm going to introduce you the fuzzy set theory and its application. Why study fuzzy set theory? In the past industrial experience, most decisions are made under uncertainty. Problems are harder to be defined than to solve. For example, to describe the concept of demand is strong, the inventory level is low, the purchase amount is large. While making the decision, problems are harder to define, so to make the decision, to describe the concepts of those linguistic variables, the traditional set theory might need to be extended. 在日常生活里面，因为我们的想法都是由许多模糊的概念所组成，例如大小、冷、热、快、慢，这些都是没有明确的内涵跟外延，所以传统的集合理论没有办法在我们在 model 问题的时候来帮助我们描述这些概念，模糊的概念。所以做决策的时候，我们往往遇到的困难是不知道如何去定义问题，而非去解一个问题。 Fuzzy set theory is proposed by Zade. He's a UC Berkeley professor. He proposed the fuzzy set theory in 1965.在模糊集合理论是美国加州大学教授，他在1965年所创立的。Why study fuzzy set theory? Because the fuzzy logic is going to make the future perfectly clear. 这是 Zade 教授他的名言。It's a famous sentence by Professor Zade. In the past industrial experience, most decisions are made under uncertainty. The theory of fuzzy sets enables us to structure and describe imprecise activities and observations, formulate them in models, and use these models for various purposes such as problem solving and decision making. For instance,In an inventory control problem, a control rule may look like this. If demand is strong and the inventory level is low, then purchase amount is large. Fuzzy set theory helps us to define those linguistic variables, strong, low, large, for control theory. The controls, fuzzy control theory is developed based on fuzzy mathematics, including fuzzy set theory, fuzzy linguistic variables, and fuzzy inference rule. I will show you how to make the decision by using fuzzy control later. 在 Zade 教授1965年的时候，他提出的这个模糊集合理论呢，他们其实是应用在控制的问题上面。那模糊控制理论，它主要是以模糊数学为基础。那模糊数学包含什么呢？包含模糊集合理论，包含模糊语言变数跟模糊逻辑推理这些。那在这根据这些就是说语规的这个表示方法去描述模糊推理。然后再进而制定控制决策，这个是模糊控制理论他在做的事情。Now, if we have enough time today, I will show you how to make the decision by using fuzzy control later. Another important application of fuzzy set theory is on solving mathematical programming problems in a fuzzy environment. 模糊集合理论它除了在最早的时候是应用在控制模糊控制学门上，那在我们作业研究的这个数学规划建模上的应用也十分的重要跟广泛。So, we know linear optimization models can be very useful since most decisions are made under uncertainty. Linear programming in a fuzzy environment is an important topic both in theory and application. 要说这个要跟同学介绍线性规划问题的，就模糊数学规划，我们从模糊线性规划开始讲起。It is a canonical form of linear programming. 这个是线性规划的这个标准式，大家应该都有上过线性规划，是吧？In the canonical form of linear programming, we have maximize or minimize an objective function such that the resource constraint resources such that all the variables satisfy certain resource limitation. Therefore, we have some resource constraints which are linear, and all the action variables are to be non-negative. This is a linear programming in its canonical form. The linear optimization model is very useful, and since most decisions are made under uncertainty, linear programming in a fuzzy environment could be very useful and important for your future research. Here is an example of a fuzzy linear programming problem. In this example, there are two variables, x and y. Our objective is to maximize x plus y such that x minus 3y less than or equal to a fuzzy number 7. And also x plus 2y approximately less than or equal to 100. That means x plus 2y doesn't need to be strictly satisfy the inequality less than or equal to, and it can be softened. That means we only need it to be approximately less than or equal to 100. So how to, in this constraint, the tolerance in resources are allowed. Therefore, to model this linear programming problem in a fuzzy environment, we have to learn some basic concept about fuzzy mathematics first. That's the motivation of why study fuzzy set theory. Okay. Here is a simple case study example about fuzzy linear programming. Before our lecture to start introduce the fuzzy set theory, I would like you to see this example first, so you get some idea why we need to learn fuzzy numbers, like in the model one, or we need to learn the fuzzy arithmetic in those fuzzy numbers. Okay, the simple example, this is a simple case study. In this example, it says that a feed mill has only one production line, which can produce three kinds of feeds, A, B, and C. Feed A consumes 2 tons of type 1 raw materials per unit. Feed B consumes 3 tons of type 1 raw materials and 2 tons of type 2 raw materials per unit. And type C consumes 5 tons of type 2 raw material per unit. The plant currently has around 8 tons of type 1 raw materials, around 10 tons of type 2 raw materials. To model this to model the resource limitation in the description. At first, if we assume that the variable x1 represents the quantity or number of feed A, x2 represents the number of feed B, x3 represents the quantity of feed C, then based on the description above, we see that feed A consumes 2 tons of type 1 raw material, and feed B, since feed B consumes 3 tons of type 1 raw material, therefore 2x1 plus 3x2 has to be less than or equal to the fuzzy number 8, because the problem says that the plant currently has around 8 tons of type 1 raw materials. So around 8 tons of type 1 raw materials is the concept of fuzzy. Therefore, the number 8 could be fuzzy. So we have the first constraint, 2x1 plus 3x2 less than or equal to fuzzy number 8. Similarly, since type 2 raw material has around 10 tons, the resource limitation is fuzzy 10. Therefore, we found that for type 2 raw material, we have the feed B consumes 2 tons of type 2 material, and the feed C consumes 5 tons of type 2 material. Therefore, 2x2 plus 5x3 will be less than or equal to the fuzzy number 10. So in this linear programming model, there are some fuzzy numbers appears. Here is another constraint of this in this study. The problem says that it takes 3 hours of production time for producing feed A per unit and 2 hours of production time for producing feed B per unit. The production of feed C requires 4 hours of production time per unit, and the total production time per day is 16 hours. The factory allows a small amount of overtime work. The last sentence says that although the total production time per day is 16 hours, but since the factory allows a small amount of overtime work, therefore the constraint of 3x1 plus 2x2 plus 4x3 doesn't need to be strictly less than or equal to 16. It allows some tolerance in the constraint, in the inequality. Therefore, this constraint 3x1 plus 2x2 plus 4x3 would be approximately less than or equal to 16. So the constraint you see now is different than what you have learned in the traditional linear programming problem. Okay, about the objective function, the problem says that the profit per ton of feed A is 30,000 yen, and the profit per ton of feed B is 50,000 yen, and the profit per ton of feed C is 40,000 yen. How to arrange the production quantity of the identified feed to ensure that the factory can get the most economic benefit? Objective is to maximize Z equal to 3x1 plus 5x2 plus 4x3. Therefore, the linear programming problem in a fuzzy environment would look like problem 2. We have to maximize the objective function and the total profit, and such that all the variables x1, x2, x3 satisfies those resource limitations. is the example clear to you? 我讲中文讲一次好吗？我不确定你们是不是有修过线性规划，应该是有吧？
有。
那 no? No?
Yes, yes, yes. Yeah. Yes.
Okay. I think linear programming is a basic class. 我记得我在念清大的时候，虽然我是应用数学系的学生，但是我大三的时候就有在工业工程系修了线性规划的课，应该是大学部的同学可能就有修过。那研究所的同学如果没有听过的话，没有关系，这个跟高中的时候讲，好像也有讲过一些类似的基本的想法啊。那这个问题就是说，假设呢，这个如果今天有一个这个 feed mill 啊，一个工厂，它要去生产三种东西 A、B、C 啊，三种饲料好了。那这三种三种产品在生产的时候呢，它当然会需要消耗一些这个 raw material。那 raw material 有两种，一种是 type 1，一种是 type 2。那他就会说明说，在我们线性规划的问题，在帮人家做建模的时候，就是 modeling 的时候，你就是去了解他题目，就是说他题目的描述，像他就会说，哎，产品呢，你要制造它需要两吨的 raw material type 1 raw material。那这个第二种产品呢，需要在制造它的时候，每单位呢需要三吨的 type 1 raw material 跟两吨的 type 2 raw material。好，然后第三种产品呢，它在这个每单位制造它，你知道每单位的第三种产品需要五吨的这个 type 2 material。然后它当然不是无限，就是这个 raw material type 1 type 2都是有限制的哦。它大约就是说你八吨左右的 type 1 raw material 跟十吨左右的 type 2这个 raw material。所以我们在做决策的时候，其实往往就是看他题目最后问你什么，你就令他是变数。他题目刚刚就问你说 How to arrange the production quantity to ensure that the factory can get most economy benefit。 他就是说，哎，这个到底要怎么生产哦？这三种产品你要各生产多少的量，有没有？他问你 production quantity， 然后呢能够使得这个工厂的获利最大，好，所以这个目标函数当然就是算它的获利，好，那这个等一下我们再说。那我就令他最后问说你要怎么去 arrange 这个 production quantity， 所以我们就令三个产品 A、B、C 分别的量是 X1、X2、X3， 好，那你有了这个变数令好了之后，那你就可以根据题目的意思哦，它有哪一些限制。他说 type 1 raw material 只有八吨左右，所以谁会用到 type 1 raw material 呢？就是你去生产那个第一种产品 A 跟第二种产品 B 的时候。好，那每生产一单位的 A 产品呢需要消耗两吨，所以就是总共需要的这个 type 1 raw material 是 2x1。 那这个 type 2这个第二种产品啊 feed B， 它会消每生产一单位它要消耗三吨嘛，三吨的 raw material 1，所以就是假 3x2， 那要大就小于等于 fuzzy number 8，好，所以它是这样令出来的。那同理这个第二种 raw material type 2，它在生产的时候它的量只有十这么多，大约十这么多，所以它给的其实就是一个 fuzzy number。那它在 model 的过程中就会有这个 fuzzy number 出现。那一般我们在解线性规划问题的时候，其实很容易哦，用这个 simplest method， 或者是如果只有两个变数，甚至用图形法就可以解。但是当它有 fuzzy number 在里面，好，还有就是它的，你看这个第三个限制是它的 fuzzy 是出现在它把它的不等式柔性化了 ，soften 了。所以它只要 approximate less than or equal to， 这都不是跟我们之前学的这个传统集合的观念都不太一样，所以我们才要导入模糊集合理论，就是说在我们建模的时候它会帮助我们。 OK， so I know some of you have learned linear programming before and some of you did not, so I explain the example by showing you how to construct a linear programming model slowly. I hope you understand how we obtain this fuzzy linear programming problem now. 希望大家现在比较知道这个 model 怎么长出来的、哦、linear programming model basically has an objective function. We want to maximize or minimize. In this problem, we want to maximize the benefit, the profit, and such that all the variables satisfy those constraints. Okay? Okay. To solve problem two, the linear programming problem in a fuzzy environment, or to make a decision for the fuzzy inventory control problem, we have to learn the fuzzy set theory. That's the motivation why study fuzzy set theory. Okay. Fuzzy set theory, what's fuzzy set theory? Fuzzy set theory can be considered as an extension of traditional set theory. A fuzzy set can be considered as a collection of all the elements in the universe. 模糊集合里面的元素哦，这是一个模糊集合，我们一般都是用一个 theta 来表示，就是模糊的意思。 Fuzzy set A can be considered as a collection of all the elements in the universe. 在模糊集合里面的元素，它这个模糊集合里面的元素，它包含了所有宇集里面的元素。那你会说，这个老师，那就不用玩啦。你既然包含了所有宇集里的元素，那当然就是每个模糊集合哦。它each element in the fuzzy set appears in the form of pairs. 你可以看到它模糊集合里的元素长的样子跟传统集合不一样哦，它是pair 的形式出现，就是它的 the first element x is the element in the universe。And the second element, mu x, is the degree of x in the fuzzy set A. Here, mu is a membership function which maps each element in the universe to a value between 0 and 1. And the value mu theta A of x is the degree of x in the fuzzy set.所以一个模糊集合、每一个模糊集合它的元素都包含了所有宇集里的元素。那模糊集合 A 跟模糊集合 B 的差别在什么呢？就在这个 membership function、不同的 membership function 刻画了不同的这个模糊集合。因此这个 membership function我们有给它另一个名称叫特征函数 characteristic function. Since fuzzy sets can be considered as a collection of all the elements in a universe, therefore the difference for fuzzy set A and fuzzy set B would be based on the membership function of a fuzzy setDefined it. Here is an example. 如果听不懂没关系，等一下我会重回来再讲一次。好，先听第一次。Here is an example of a fuzzy set. If I would like to define real numbers close to 10, all the real numbers can be close to 10, but have different degree. For example,The real number 10 is very close to 10, so it has a degree equal to 1. Remember, the degree of the element x in the universe is mu of x. Mu is a number between 0 and 1, so the largest value is equal to 1.这个 mu 可以把它想成是 mu 的值，可以想成是这个元素隶属于模糊集合 A 的隶属函数值。Okay, the degree of the mu can be represented as the degree of the element x in the universe, related to the fuzzy set A. Therefore, like the number 9 and the number 11, I would say they have the same degree in the fuzzy set A, real numbers close to 10, 因为9跟11都一样的靠近10，对不对？所以他们的这个 membership degree 我就给他设是一样的，都是 0.5。那你记得 membership degree mu is a value between 0 and 1。好，那会有一点感觉跟那个集合理论里面的几率里面的那个几率值好像都介于零一之间有点关系哈。那但是这个等一下我们会讲这个他们的差别，就是这个模糊集合跟几率的这个都是零一之间的这个值的那种差别性。OK， to represent the membership function for the fuzzy set A, real numbers close to 10, we may use the distance function represent the fuzzy set, the membership function of fuzzy set A. 我们可以看到就是在这个例子里面、哦、我要描述的一个模糊集合是 real numbers close to 10。那它的 membership function 我们可以选取谁呢？选取这个距离函数，距离函数是非常有名的、在数学里面它越靠近10呢它这个分母就越小，对不对？那所以它的隶属函数值就越大，可以哈？所以它就越靠近10它的隶属函数值就越大，那这样子的一个距离函数在设计的时候它的值就会介于0一之间，所以它可以被用来当做这个模糊集合 A 它的 real numbers close to 10的、就是说 membership function。 好，那你会问我说 how to find a membership function for a fuzzy set, right? It's something we have to learn later, okay? As I said that fuzzy set can be considered as an extension of traditional set. Here is an example of a traditional set. There are two sets A and B. If set A has the collection of even numbers, for example, 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, and the set B has prime numbers, for example, 2, 3, 5, 7. Okay, we can consider in the traditional set theory, for each element in the universe belongs to A, the set A, then it has a characteristic function value equal to 1. If the element is not in the set A, then it is assigned a value of 0. Therefore, a traditional set can become consider as a collection of all the element x in the universe with characteristic function equal to 1. 在传统的集合，我们在令的时候，我们都知道说，哪些集合在集合 A 里，在集合 B 里呢？你就去看它如果在集合 A 里，我们就给它一个特征函数值一。那不在集合 不在集合 A 里，我们就给它一个特征函数零。那这个 A 集合可以想象成是所有语集里的元素具有这个特征函数值是零，是一的，啊，所以在这个我们在定这个 in the ordinary set theory, we consider for a crisp set A in the universe can be defined as a collection of all the elements with characteristic function equal to 1.And its characteristic function is defined as a value 0 or 1. If the element in the set A, then it will have a characteristic function value equal to 0, otherwise is equal to 0. Therefore, crisp traditional set A is simply can be represented by the collection of all the elements in the universe with characteristic function equal to 1. 所以在其实在传统的集合理论呢里面， 我们就已经有提到这个特征函数或者是 membership function 的观念，只是我们没有特别强化它。那the fuzzy set theory can be considered as an extension of the ordinary traditional set. In a traditional set, we have a characteristic function which assigns in each element in the universe a value 0 or 1. But in the fuzzy set, we define the extension of the characteristic function to be membership function, which is a function mu mapping each element in the universe to a value between 0 and 1. Therefore, the fuzzy set A can be represented as a collection of all the elements in the universe, but appears in a pair, in a form of pairs. And the first element of each element in the fuzzy set is an element in the universe, and the second element in the the second element represents the degree of the element X in the fuzzy set A. That's how that they define a fuzzy set. 那大家在定义模糊集合的时候，它因为没有办法去明确的说语集里的元素是不是在这个模糊集合里面，好，所以我们就把语集里的所有的元素都抓进来这个模糊集合，但是呢，每一个人每个元素都给它贴上一个，就是说 attach a degree of X in the fuzzy set A. Therefore, each element in the universe is a element in the fuzzy set, but with different degree in the fuzzy set A. 所以它的基本概念是这样。那 then it's clear that membership function plays an important role while defining a fuzzy set.Any questions so far? 可以听得懂吗？
有人有问题要问吗？
有，那是不是可以把它理解成，就是如果是在 fuzzy set， 它是比较像连续的概念；那如果是在 traditional set， 是一种 discrete 的概念。
因为我举的这个例子啊，像你现在荧幕上看到这个例子哈。Fuzzy set A is real numbers close to 10. 它是就是说它我给它的那个membership function 是一个连续的函数，对不对？所以你会觉得它是这个它跟连续有关。那如果另一个角度来看，就是我们定义这个传统集合的时候 ，in the traditional set， 每一个语集里的元素如果隶属这个传统这个集合呢，我们就给它一个值是一，否则的话没有隶属就是零。所以它是就是亚里士多德他们在当时定集合论的时候讲的所谓的二值论啊，你在这个集合或不在这个集合就两种情形而已。好，这是传统集合的定法。那模糊集合呢，他就觉得每个人都在，所以每个人都在，但是都在呢都在。隶属函数值是零也叫在，隶属值函数值是一也是在，所以是零到一之间的这个所有可能，就是说给它一个值介于零到一之间就可以。那如果你所谓的连续跟离散呢，你刚刚提到连续离散指的是这个隶属函数值的概念，那这样说是可以的，因为就是说传统集合的隶属函数值就只有零一两种嘛，好，那离散的感觉。那在这个模糊集合里面呢，它的隶属函数值呢可以是零一到一之间的任何数，有点像几率论里面讲的几率，对不对？几率值好是零一之间任何数，所以你可以把它想成是连续的观念也可以。这样听得懂吗？
听得懂。那这样子意思是说，
okay.
在 fuzzy set 那个 x belong 大 x 那一个符号，代表是只要在这个 s 里面，它即使在语集里面都有可能会发生。
对，就是像。For example, if I would like to define a fuzzy set A, which are real numbers close to 10, then my universe might be the real numbers. 就是我的语集呢， 当我在定义所有时数靠近时的时数的时候，那 我的语集里面的元素就是一些时数 real number。 好，那每一个 real number 它都可以说它靠近时，一般也靠近时，但是隶属程度可能只有零。
了解，谢谢。
一百可能靠近时，但是隶属函数隶属程度 OK。 Okay, so how to define fuzzy membership functions which characterize a fuzzy set? 在一个模糊集合里面，我们看得到它的重要的是，就是它那个 membership function 怎么令啊？它刻画了你这个模糊集合的样子啊。那there are many methods to define membership functions. For example, the distance approach.Which was used to define the concept for the concept of near, close, to, around. 在我们在描述什么近啊、远啊、附近的时候，最常用的就是这个距离函数，因为它刚好定义出来是介于零到一之间的一个值，所以我们常把它用来当 membership function. And there are many statistic approaches, or we use expertise approach.To have some experience, industrial experience. 这有这么多的这个方法啊，不过我们等一下会在下面的介绍中不同的例子里面让同学看到这个 membership function 啊，那它的样子，然后在不同应用里面它是怎么生成的。大部分我们希望 membership function 是线性的。We would prefer to design or define membership functions for our model so that it's convenient for the computer to compute it for us. 就是在计算上的方便，像我们在写论文啊，在定义你的 model 的 membership function 的时候，我们一般会希望用线性的，因为你可以看文献上期刊论文里面大部分都喜欢用线性的，尤其是管理工业工程管理的，因为他们的数学比较没那么好，所以他们喜欢用线性的。但是像其实在像 AI 的问题里面，我们模糊集合 fuzzy set theory can be applied to artificial intelligence of course. For example, fuzzy neural network, the membership function they employed mostly are not linearly.They are like a sigmoid, 有时候是那种 sigmoid function 是常见的，然后在做这个AI 的时候，这个就是模糊类神经网络这些的时候，我们都是用 sigmoid function, 那它的这个就不会是线性的 membership function, 那这个都是后来的应用。好，那今天我们就先做一个简介，那推看到我慢慢往后在读书，你会看到在看论文的时候，你会看到不同的应用呢，他们会有他的道理在，好，那都会有好的方法去解释。好 ，OK， after introduce the fuzzy set, then similarly to traditional set theory, we have to introduce.The set operation in a fuzzy environment. Here is an example. If I have a fuzzy set A, which represent numbers considerably larger than 10, then the membership function would look like this one. 如果我的模糊集合是 A, 那些实数呢比这个我们这边写 number 就是指 real number 哈，实数。比十大的实数，所以比十大的实数呢，可能当然越大，隶属函数值隶属于这个模糊集合的隶属函数值就越大。好，所以它是这种递增的形式。它 membership function 就可以这样令。好，你看这是很自然的。你说怎么令 membership function？ 有时候就是你的经验 industrial experience。And also, if I have another fuzzy set B.Which represent numbers approximately equals to 11. 假设我今天另一个模糊集合是靠近11的实数，好，那当然它会这个 membership function 会有点像距离，就是刚刚那例子一样，我们用那个 distance function can characterize its membership function. Okay, now I would be interested in what's the intersection of two fuzzy sets and what's the union of two fuzzy sets. 在我们刚刚讲的这个，比方说那个 linear programming 的 case study in the linear programming case study example, we have different constraints.For example, we have three constraints. Each one can be represented of a fuzzy set. So to solve this fuzzy linear programming problem, we will consider all the variables, decision variables, has to satisfy all the constraints of all the fuzzy sets simultaneously. That means we have to know what's the intersection of those different fuzzy sets. Okay, so the intersection, how to represent the intersection of fuzzy sets will be the next topic we are going to introduce. To define the intersection or union of fuzzy set operationSimilar to a set, ordinary set operation, it can be reconsidered as an extension of the set operation. In the set operation, we define a set CRISP transitional set A is a collection of all the element in the universe with a characteristic function value equal to one. The set operation for two transitional set, for example, the union of two set A and B can be considered as X in X in the universe, which is in the set A or in the set B. Therefore, the union, the characteristic function of the union of set A and B can be considered as maxima of the membership function, the characteristic function of set A and X in the set A and X in the set B. 这个看的，这个知道意思吗？我们可以举例哦，就是在我们讲传统集合的联集的时候，这个元素 X 会是在 A 跟 B 的联集里面。好，那表示说这个X 可能在 A 也可能在 B， 所以它在 A 跟 B 的值呢可能是一或零或零或零或一或零一或一一，好，四种可能。那只要是因为或的话，我只要取零一的这个 maxima 就可以了，对，只要有这个，就是也就是说，如果这个元素 X 它是在这个 A 跟 B 的联集里面，它只要在 A或 B 就可以，所以只要有一个人是一就可以，所以我取 maxima。Okay, similarly, the intersection of two sets, we observe its characteristic function can be defined as the minima of the element x in the characteristic function value of x in the set A or and B.所以像交集，我们在定交集的时候，就是这个元素 X 在 A 跟 B 的交集里，那么表示说这个元素同时属于 A 集合也同时属于 B 集合，所以他们这个开这个就是说这个开 A 开 X 跟开 A 跟开 B 都要这个同时的话，那就是同时的话就是取小的，所以那补集的意思的the complement of a set A, it means that if X is not in set A, so of course if it is in A, then it will not be in the complement of set A. Therefore, it's the membership function, the characteristic function of the complement of set A would be 1 minus the characteristic function of set A. So,我想同学对于这个，因为我们刚刚希望把这个传统的集合跟模糊集合做一个，就是说把模糊集合想象成是传统集合的延伸，好，所以 在做这个 extension 的时候，我们要把这个membership function 或特征函数的想法拉出来，然后再延伸到模糊集合里面。So, the fuzzy set operation can be considered as an extension of the traditional set operation. Therefore, we define the membership function of the union of two fuzzy sets is equal to maxima of the membership function of fuzzy set A and the membership function of fuzzy set B. Here is a notation we used to use for maxima. The intersection of two fuzzy sets will has the membership function defined it as the minima of the membership function A and the membership function B with a notation like a week. Okay. And the membership function for the complement of fuzzy set A is equal to 1 minus the membership function of fuzzy set A. 这个应该不奇怪，因为它其实直接就是从传统集合里面这个将观念延伸过来。But sometimes we can see that in the application, people might not use a maxima of two of the membership function of two fuzzy sets represent the union of them.And they use the so-called T-known or S-known. 那个是就是说有时候因为 用 maxima 表示两个这个联集，两个模糊集合联集产生了新的模糊集合，它的隶属函数是用原来两个集合的 membership function 的这个极大值 maxima， 而交集是用极小，这个是比较简便的方法。那它也是用传统集合的观念过来的。那但是有的书它会用到讲到 T-known 跟 S-known， 好，那同学有概念就好，如果需要用到这么复杂再去看它。好，那一般都只是用穿，这个就是说像我们在做 fuzzy control 的时候，一般就是有好多个 rule， 对不对？ Different control rules has to be satisfied, so we consider its intersection of all those rules. Therefore, the minimization operation is the most commonly used while doing either fuzzy control or solving the fuzzy mathematical programming problem. 所以在真的我们在用的时候，我们实际在做问题的时候，不管是业界在做那个模糊控制，或者是我们在做建模的时候，都是用这个 minima 表示这个 session， 就是说 intersection 交集不同的模糊集合。的交集，它的 membership function 我们都是用就是所有的模糊集合它的这个交集来用，这个是常常用到的。好，所以我这边希望同学特别有点印象，交集我们一般模糊集合交集我们一般都是用 minimize。 Okay, and here is an example of the intersection and the union. If I have a fuzzy set Awhich has a membership function, it's a piecewise, it's divided piecewisely. For example, the fuzzy set A has a membership function divided when x between 1 to 2, it's a linear function y equal to x minus 1. And for x between 2 to 3, it's a function, it's a linear line, a function equal to 1 equal to minus x plus 3. And similarly, we define a membership function for fuzzy set B, which can be defined as when x between 2 to 3, then we have membership 1 equals 2, and more x between 3, and the membership 1 minus x plus, this is the line. For this, the value is equal to 0, okay? So example, the intersection of fuzzy set A and B well has the membership function, which is the minimization of membership function A and and membership function B. Therefore, it can be represented as the red one. Hello?
老师你的声音变断断续续。
Yes.
听不太没办法连成一个句子了。老师你的声音变断断续续的。现在还是网络的问题吗？这样呢？哦，这样变顺了。哦，好了好了。我猜可能有点是网络的问题。好，现在可以了。
好，谢谢。好，如果不行的时候，你再跟我讲，好吗？好，OK. This is an example of the how to find the membership function for the intersection of two fuzzy sets. If we would like to find the intersection, the membership function for intersection of fuzzy set A and fuzzy set B, then in this example, the intersection of fuzzy set A and fuzzy set B is.
老师又断了。那我换一个位置看看好了。好啊。<笑>
等我一下哦。好的。可能是网络吧，因为我在这个房间比较角落一点。这样子呢？好像可以。好，那我试试看，我们再继续讲。好。OK. In this example, we can see that the intersection, the membership function for fuzzy set A and B can be taken as a minimization of the two membership function, fuzzy set A, the membership function A and the membership function B. Therefore, their intersection is a red one. It can be represented by a piecewise linear function when x between 2 and 2.5 is y equal to x minus 2. And for x between 2.5 to 3, then it's y equal to minus 3 plus 3, minus x plus 3. To define the union, the membership function of the union for fuzzy set A and B, which we take the maximize of the two membership functions, therefore it could be the one divided. It's like a big M here. So this one, this big M can be represented as the union, the membership function of the union of two fuzzy sets, and which can be represented as a piecewise linear function for x between 1 to 2. This is the line y equal to x minus 1. For x between 2 to 2.5, it's the line y equal to minus 3 plus minus x plus 3. And for x between 2.5 to 3, it's the line y equal to x minus 2. And for x between 3 to 4, this is the line y equal to minus x plus 4. 这个例子它是在讲那个两个模糊集合的交集跟联集所产生新的模糊集合它的 membership function 是怎么令的。好，那在定交集的时候呢，就是两个模糊集合的交集还是一个模糊集合，那它的 membership function 我们一般是就是找这个模糊集合 A 跟模糊集合 B membership function 的取小的，所以取小的像1到2之间，这个因为 membership function B 它的值是0，所以取小的就是0。那 2到2.5之间，他们两个取小的就是红的这一条线，那 2.5到3之间取小的就是这一条红线。好，那如果是 联集的话，两个模糊集合的联集还是一个模糊集合，那这个新的模糊集合它 membership function 是怎么link的呢？我们就是link模糊集合 A 跟模糊集合 B 这两个 membership function 的这个取大的，取大的。那像一到二之间大的就是这个 A， 对不对？然后二到二点五之间就是模糊集合 A 的 membership function， 然后二点五到三之间呢，就是取模糊集合 B 的 membership function， 因为我们都取大的。那三到十之间就是取模糊集合 B 的 membership function， 所以写起来它是这个分段的线性函数。好，那这个同学可以就是有一个感觉，好，就是两个模糊集合的交集跟联集产生新的模糊集合，它的 membership function 是这样子定的。 After introducing the set operation in fuzzy set theory, we will introduce the definition of fuzzy numbers. Fuzzy numbers appears frequently in the modeling of fuzzy mathematical programming. 我们可以看到这个在我们其实我们在读 paper 的时候，只要是模糊集合的应用，不管在管理上还是工程上，大量的使用到模糊数 fuzzy number 模糊数，然后模糊数之间的运算，这个都是我们要知道它的基本原理，然后才能够请计算机帮我们去做。 So we will introduce different fuzzy numbers. There are four different fuzzy numbers. The first one is called triangular fuzzy number. The second one is called trapezoid fuzzy number.And bell-shaped fuzzy number and non-symmetric fuzzy numbers. Triangular fuzzy number, 顾名思义，三角模糊数，就是因为它的 membership function 是三角形的。好，这是最常见的。The triangular fuzzy number, can be the membership function will look like a triangular. That's why it's called triangular fuzzy number. It can be defined by four different.Piecewise lines, as what we did in the example before. The triangular fuzzy number is commonly represented by three numbers. The first number n means the center of the fuzzy number, and the second number alpha means the left spread from the center to the left end.And the third notation beta means the right spread from the center to the right end. Here is an example. In this example, if I would like to represent a fuzzy number 3, of course, the center would be 3. And I can give you the left spread and the right spread, which is equal to 1 and 2.To characterize this fuzzy number 3. 我们如果最常用的，其实最常用的模糊数，大家都是用三角模糊数，因为它在定义上面比较简单。好，那三角模糊数，比方说我要定义模糊数3，那它的 center 就是那个隶属函数值最高的地方，然后一般就是一呀，给它的值是一，那我们就是03就是它那个 center。好，然后呢再给左右看你的这个容忍度有多大 tolerance， 可以给一可以给二。好，所以会是就是说这是一个 triangular fuzzy number 的 example。The second commonly used fuzzy number is called trapezoid fuzzy number. The trapezoid fuzzy number because the shape of the membership function looks like a trapezoid. Therefore,It can be defined piecewisely by a linear line x minus a divided b minus a for x between a and b. And for x between b to c, we can define the membership value equal to 1. And for x between c to d, then it can be defined by a line x minus d divided by c minus d and the zeros in for otherwise. 这个梯形模糊数它其实比较像是就是 三角模糊数的一个延伸。To represent a trapezoid fuzzy number, we use four symbols to represent it. The first two symbols, N1, N2, represent the left center and the right center of the fuzzy number. Alpha and beta represent the left spread and the right spread of this fuzzy number. For example, we can define fuzzy number 3 or say fuzzy number 4 like this. The first two elements in the fuzzy set in this trapezoid fuzzy number means the left center and the right center of the fuzzy number. And 1, 1 means the left spread and right spread of this fuzzy number. 所以这个梯形模糊数 它比那个三角模糊数多了一个 center， 因为它的那个上面这个不再是尖的，它可以是梯形的，是平的，所以它的这个 center 有 左边的 center 跟右边 center， left center and right center， 像35一开始定义的35就是它的左 center 跟右 center， 那后面的这两个1跟1就表示是它的那个 left spread 跟 right spread。 所以trapezoid fuzzy number can be considered as an extension of triangular fuzzy number. 那这是两种最常用的这个模糊数。 Another fuzzy number called bell-shaped fuzzy number, it's like a bell shape, so can be represented as a probability function. 这个 bell shape 中型的模糊数 membership function 当然可以用我们在几率里面常见的那个 normal distribution 有没有它的表示法，哦，就是用 exponential function 去表示它。但是它因为，在计算上会比较麻烦，所以一般很少人用。那这种是更少人用，就是the last fuzzy number I would like to introduce you is called non-LOR type fuzzy number. Non-LOR type fuzzy number means that the fuzzy number has a center B.And with left spread A and right spread C, but since the left part and the right part both are nonlinearly, so it can be defined by different nonlinear function according to the problem you define. So that's the we seldom use this, but you might see this in some applications. Okay. How to operate those fuzzy numbers? We will introduce fuzzy arithmetics in the following. Fuzzy arithmetics, of course, including addition, subtraction, and multiplication and division. Fuzzy addition, the first arithmetic we would like to introduce you.Is called is a fuzzy addition. 模糊加减乘除是模糊数里面第一个我们要跟同学介绍的。其实因为它的道理等一下我会介绍，但是我想先跟同学讲公式。好，那公式的介绍上你就会觉得好像还蛮简单的。People has the formulation, have built the formulation for fuzzy addition, fuzzy subtraction, for triangular fuzzy number, and the trapezoid fuzzy numbers. Therefore, it can be easily used. For example, the fuzzy addition for triangular fuzzy number can be considered in this way. If I have a triangular fuzzy number x, alpha, beta,and another triangular fuzzy number with a center y and left spread gamma, right spread delta, the addition, fuzzy addition for two fuzzy numbers is still a fuzzy triangular fuzzy number, which has a center x plus y with a left spread alpha plus gamma and the right spread beta plus delta. For the case of trapezoid fuzzy number,the fuzzy addition for two trapezoid fuzzy number is still a trapezoid fuzzy number with a left center x1 plus y1 right center s2 plus y2 left spread alpha plus gamma and the right spread beta plus delta. The formulation can be proved later. I will show you. Basically, they use the concept of alpha level cut. So after define, introduce you the alpha level cut concept, I will show you how to find the, how to obtain those results. So for the trapezoid fuzzy number here, we can easily see that if this is fuzzy set, if this is my trapezoid fuzzy number n1, n2, with left spread alpha 1, beta 1, and this is another trapezoid fuzzy number with left center m1, m2, with left spread alpha 2 and beta 2. The addition of those two fuzzy numbers is still a trapezoid fuzzy number with the center n1 plus m n left, which should be n1 plus m1, and the right center is n2 plus m2. I think the notation here is has some mistake. Should be n1 plus m1 here and n2 plus m2 for the right center. And with the left spread, alpha 1 plus alpha 2 here, it's correct. And with the right spread, alpha 1, beta 1 plus beta 2. So it's easy to remember for fuzzy addition. Here is an example. If I have fuzzy number 2, define it like this, which is a triangular fuzzy number. For x between 0 and 2 is equal to the membership function is y equal to x divided by 2. For x between 2 and 4, the membership function is defined by 4 minus x divided by 2. And if I have another fuzzy number 8 with the membership function, which is with center 8, and with left spread, which is equal to 5, right? 8 minus 3. With right spread, which is 11 minus 3, which is 3. Then the addition of those two triangular fuzzy numbers based on our formulation could be the center could be 2 plus 8, which is 10. With the left spread, 2 plus 5, which is 7, 10 minus 3. With the right spread, 3 plus, here's 5, so which is 8. No, it should be 2 plus, here is 2 plus 3, should be 5. Am I right? 我用中文讲一下，假设模糊数2跟模糊数8，我们是把它定义成三角模糊数。那模糊数2呢，它的中心当然是2，它的 left spread 是2， right spread 是2。模糊数8，它的中心是这个8，那它的 left spread 是5， right spread 是3。所以两个三角模糊数相加，它还是一个三角模糊数。它的 center 10呢，就是刚刚的二跟八，它的这个相加，那它的 left spread 是十减三十七，七是怎么来的呢？就是刚刚这个二的 left spread 二加上八的 left spread 五来的，所以是七。那这个模糊数二，模糊二加模糊八呢，它的 right spread 呢是五，五是怎么来的呢？就是刚刚这个模糊数二的。它的 right spread 2加上模糊数8的 right spread 是3，所以是5，是这样来的。所以那个公式其实很好用。那至于为什么会是这样，等一下我们介绍那个 alpha level cut 观念后会回来讲。OK， the formulation for fuzzy subtraction of triangular fuzzy numbers would be under the formulation for fuzzy subtraction.For the trapezoid fuzzy numbers are similar as what we defined for fuzzy addition. But you can see that the the subtraction for two triangular Fuzzy number is still a triangular Fuzzy number with center x minus y, and with left spread and right spread, which would be alpha plus theta and beta plus gamma. That means the subtraction of two Fuzzy number will has the larger spread than the two Fuzzy numbers, and the Fuzzy subtraction of the trapezoid two trapezoid Fuzzy numbers is still a trapezoid Fuzzy number with the left center x1 minus y2 and the right center x2 minus y1 and with left spread alpha plus theta and right spread beta plus gamma. It can also be proved. The formulation can be proved after we introduce the concept of alpha level set. Here is an example of the fuzzy subtraction of two trapezoid fuzzy numbers. The first trapezoid number with center n1, n2, and left spread alpha 1, beta 1. The second trapezoid number has left center m1, m2, and the left spread alpha 2 and beta 2. You can see that the subtraction of these two fuzzy numbers with the will still be a trapezoid fuzzy number with the left center n1 plus n1 minus m2 with the right center n2 minus m1 and with the left spread alpha 1 plus beta 2 and the right spread beta 1 plus alpha 2. Okay. The formulation can be proved by alpha level set concept. So I think to introduce the concept of an alpha level set is very important. In the example of fuzzy set, fuzzy number 2 and fuzzy number 8, you can see that if I have fuzzy number 2, fuzzy number 8, both of them are triangular fuzzy numbers as defined it before, then the subtraction of those two fuzzy numbers will have center minus 6. How to have minus 6? Because 2 minus 8, which is minus 6. And the left spread is 5, right? How to obtain 5? Because the left spread is 2 and the right spread of the number 8 is 3. So 2 plus 3 is 5. Therefore, the left spread for the fuzzy subtraction of fuzzy number 2 and fuzzy number 8 will be 5. So here is an example. You have the PDF file, so you can go back to, you can, after go back, you can spend some time to check that. After introduce fuzzy addition, fuzzy subtraction, of course, we have to talk about fuzzy multiplication. If I have two triangular fuzzy number, is the fuzzy multiplication of those two triangular fuzzy numbers still triangular fuzzy number? The answer is no. As you can see in this example, fuzzy number 2, fuzzy number 8 are both triangular fuzzy numbers. The multiplication of them looks like this. They have the left side and right side of the membership function, which are not linear anymore. How to obtain those results? Of course, it's based on the alpha level set concept. What's alpha level set concept? Alpha level set is also named alpha level cut, which is a very important, I think that's the most important definition in the fuzzy set theory, because almost all my research papers are based on the alpha level cut, alpha level set to define, to transfer a fuzzy mathematical programming problem to a CRISPR transitional mathematical programming problem. 阿法 level cut 的观念，我想同学可以就说稍微听一下哈，因为像我们如果你未来有可能做研究里面会用到模糊集合理论，那怎么样把一个模糊的 model 变成你会处理的 model， 怎么把它转过来？那当然是转成传统没有模糊的 model 来做。所以如何把模糊的变成传统的？ 然后以至于你可以处理它，它用的观念就是 Alpha Level Cut 的观念。好，那 Alpha Level Cut 观念呢，同学可以看到 ，from the definition of Alpha Level Cut for each fuzzy set， you can see that the Alpha Level Cut for each fuzzy set is a crisp set， which has the element x， those x has a membership degree。 Greater than or equal to alpha. So, here is an example. 这个 alpha level set 的观念就是说，本来我们的模糊集合 A 有无穷多个元素，只要与集里的元素都是模糊集合 A 的元素，所以我不知道怎么处理它们。那我现在呢，只挑我有兴趣的有限个出来。 出来把它当做这个，就叫做我的 alpha level cut。 那这个 alpha 是一个介于 0到 1 之间的数，它一旦 cut 了下来，切下来呢，就是我只关心这些 x， 哪些 x 呢？具有隶属函数值比 alpha 大的 x， 那这些人所成的集合就是一个 crisp 的集合，就是一个传统集合，因为我只去找这些元素出来去讨论它们，去处理它们，所以它就。 就不再是整个语集里面的元素了，他只关心这些具有 membership degree 只大于等于 alpha 的。好，那 here is an example of alpha level cut. If I have a fuzzy set which is a fuzzy number 2 and with a membership function defined like this, for the fuzzy set has a center 2. And with left spread 1 and the right spread 1. Has a left spread 2 and right spread 2. Therefore, the fuzzy number 2 can be defined as x between 0 and 2, which is the line y equal to x divided by 2, and for x between 2 to 4, which is the line for y equal to 4 minus x divided by 2. The alpha level cut of this fuzzy set can be considered for those x with membership degree greater than or equal to alpha. Therefore, we can find x is a value between 2 alpha and 4 minus 2 alpha. Okay? 我们去计算的时候，我们就是给定一个 alpha 值， alpha 可以是 0到 1 之间的数，一般会给。 比方说 0.9， 因为 alpha 表示的是隶属于这个模糊集合的隶属函数值，那一般决策分析者会希望越高越好，所以我们有时候会给 0.9 或 0.8， 好，那或 0.6， 那给定了 alpha 之后，你可以去找哪一些 x， 因为你知道隶属函数值长什么样，它的函数的样子，好，你知道，所以你可以去计算哪一些 x 会大于等于 alpha 呢？好，那。 就是2α到4.2α之间的这些 x， 就是它的这个 alpha level set。所以 alpha level set 基本上是一个区间，以这个例子来讲，那它是一个区间 interval 就是 crisp set 的观念。So, in this example, we can see that the alpha level cut for each fuzzy set is a crisp set. Like for example, an interval in this example, which is a collection of all the x with membership degree greater than or equal to alpha. Okay, so the concept of alpha level cut, I hope it is clear to you now. Let's go back to the example of the fuzzy addition for the example we have, if we have two fuzzy triangular fuzzy number two and fuzzy number eight, then based on using alpha level cut for any alpha between zero and one, we can find the value, the alpha level cut for fuzzy set A and fuzzy set two. The addition for those two fuzzy sets can be considered with the alpha level cut, which is the addition of the two alpha level cut. And after you find the alpha level cut for the fuzzy addition of fuzzy number two and eight, then you can go back to find its membership function for fuzzy set two plus fuzzy set A, and you will see that which is if we have addition here, then you will see this is a membership function for, I think the figure is not correct. We will see the membership function is Z between 3 and 10 with a center equal to 10. So that's what we have here, right? 10. The center should be 10. Okay. And with left spread, which is equal to 7, and the right spread, which is equal to 5. That's how we obtain here 3 and 15, right? So that's how we obtain the membership function for two fuzzy numbers, the addition by the alpha level set. 假如是用 alpha level set 的观念去算那个刚刚我们说模糊加减乘除的结果，你就可以看到它就是先把各个模糊数，比方说模糊2加模糊8，把各个模糊数的 模糊2模糊8的 alpha level cut 先算出来，然后把它们相加之后，像3加5 alpha 跟2 alpha 相加是3加7 alpha， 那11减3 alpha 加上4减2 alpha 后是15减5 alpha， 那这个就是 fuzzy 2加 fuzzy 8 它的这个模糊数的这个 alpha level cut， 那你再把它反推回来，像刚刚是知道原来的 函数原来的 membership function， 然后找 alpha cut， 那现在是我知道 alpha cut， 我反推回来原来的 membership function， 你就可以看到它长这样。那它就是为什么我们在算那个 fuzzy apply multiplication 模糊乘的时候，你反推回来它不会是线性的，它会是这个 non-linear 的。那但是如果是加跟减，它就有这个好的性质，就是两个。 这个三角模糊数相加还是三角模糊数，两个三角模糊相减还是三角模糊数。 So that's how alpha level cut can be applied to find the fuzzy arithmetics. Okay. After we introduce the fuzzy arithmetics, let's go back to see how to solve the fuzzy linear programming problem we have. This is a linear programming problem in the simple case study. To solve this linear programming problem, you see that for each fuzzy constraint, fuzzy inequality, which can be represented as a fuzzy set. In the literature, 在文献上，我们会 有不同的学说来解模糊线性规划或模糊数学规划。To solve fuzzy linear programming model, there are two different approaches. The first one is called symmetric model approach. The other is non-symmetric model approach. 我想我们就先介绍一种就好，免得同学记太多。 Non-symmetric model considers objective functions are different from constraints and are treated differently. especially when one of the two is crisp and the other one involves fuzziness. 就在解模糊数学规划的时候，我们最常用的就是非对称型的 model。为什么非对称型呢？因为他觉得非对称型 model 就是说它的目标函数跟限制式他们是被分开来处理的。好，那不要不而不是同时处理。那当然对称型的就是同时处理。为什么会分开处理？像我们刚刚的例子，我们可以看到我们的限制式是 fuzzy 的，但是目标函数并没有 fuzzy， 所以我们就直接分开处理，有 fuzzy 的就处理，没有 fuzzy 的就另外的处理方式。好 ，so when the objective function and constraints one of the two is crisp and the other one involves fuzziness, we would suggest you to use non-symmetric model to solve it. Okay. And the non-symmetric model is proposed by Verdaguer.It says that for each fuzzy constraint, it can be represented by a fuzzy set. 既然你要把每一个模糊限制式把它用一个模糊集合来表示，那么每一个限制式呢就有一个相对的 membership function. While treating each fuzzy inequality as a fuzzy set, you have to define its membership function first. For the fuzzy constraint AXI approximately less than or equal to BI, we would suggest the membership function equal to 1 if AXI strictly less than BI, the left hand side strictly less than the right hand side. Then we will assign it the membership degree equal to 1. If theLeft-hand side xi has a value greater than bi plus a tolerance pi, then we will assign its membership degree equal to 0. For those values of axi between bi and bi plus a tolerance pi, then we give you some, the membership degree will be assigned to a value between 0 and 1.And which can be represented by this linear function 1 minus AXI minus BI divided by PI. 其实他的想法是这样，就是在你的 constraint 如果是模糊的，那这个每一个模糊的限制式都可以被想象成，就是被把它处理成一个模糊集合。那既然是模糊集合，我们就是用就是一个就去定义它的 membership function， 那它的学问就在这、哦、就是你在定这个模糊这个 membership function 的时候，对针对这个模糊限制模糊不等式 AXI 大约小于等于 BI， 你在定义它的这个 membership function 的时候，我们会很自然的就是如果 AXI 小于 BI， 那它们的隶属函数值当然就是1嘛。那如果你这个给了一个这个容忍度 PI， 你比我的 BI 加 PI 还要大了，那我就给它一个隶属函数值是0。那如果 ASI 的值介于 BI 到 BI 加 PI， 我就给它隶属函数值0到1。好，所以这个是就是大家最常用的。那for each inequality, if we treat it as a fuzzy set, we might have fuzzy membership function looks like this.Then we employ the concept of alpha level cut to find those x with a membership degree. We defined it as that greater than or equal to alpha. For those x with a membership degree, the value of axi.Well, has membership degree greater than or equal to 1, which is located between xi would be between some value less than or equal to bi plus 1 minus alpha pi. Therefore, each fuzzy inequality can be transferred to consider those xSatisfy xi less than or equal to bi plus 1 minus alpha pi. 我用中文讲一次哈，就是我们在这个每一个每一个刚刚讲的每一个 fuzzy inequality， 你都可以把它想成是一个 member， 是一个模糊集合，那它的隶属函数长这样。那我刚刚说过模糊集合我们还是没有办法处理它，因为它这个它的这个集合里面的任何人都是可以是它集合，所以所有实数都可以是它。那因此我在计算上的时候是没有办法去做处理，因此我只挑哪一些人呢，挑隶属函数值够大的人。所以我挑的人呢，以这个例子来讲，就是这些X 满足 AXI 的值比这个 BI 加上1减 Alpha PI 还要小。好，那这个值怎么算的，就是你刚刚知道这个函数嘛，所以你把 Alpha 切过来，另外是 Alpha， 那你对到的 X 就是 BI 加上1减 Alpha PI。所以它的这个 alpha level set 的人是谁呢，就是 AXI 小于等于 BI 加上一减 alpha PI 这些人。好，所以你的问题本来是有模糊的就变成了这个事实是没有模糊的了，对吧？ So to solve the linear programming with fuzzy constraints, we consider for each alpha between 0 and 1we only consider those x in the alpha level set, which is equivalent to solve this problem. And this problem is a linear programming problem. If you given alpha and pi, the value of alpha and pi are given, then it's a traditional linear programming problem. Of course, you know how to solve it. Let's consider the example we have. In this example,I have three constraints, which are including fuzziness in those three constraints. Therefore, each constraint can be considered as a fuzzy set. For the right-hand side, if the right-hand side are fuzzy coefficients, we can assume that the right-hand side has a membership function, looks like this. If bi, is less than or equal to a given value, then we assign its the membership degree equal to 1. And for the value of the right-hand side is a value between BI and BI plus the tolerance PI, then we give it a membership degree between 0 and 1. Then in this case, the right-hand side coefficient, fuzzy coefficient linear programming problem,is similar to the one we discussed with the constraint has a tolerance in the resource. 就是刚才我们讲的，就是我们刚刚讲的其实是 Verdigate 的那个 model， 它解的是这种形式。 OK， 那如果今天在我们的例子里面，我们可以看到是我们除了这种形式之外，也有 fuzzy number 在右手边指的，你只要将它的 membership function 定成这个样子，那他们就他就可以处理成跟那个 Verdigate model 里面处理的 fuzzy 要把每一个 constraint 想象成是一个 fuzzy set 一样去处理。 OK， so if you have fuzzy coefficient on the right hand side and we assume that each fuzzy number of the right hand side has membership functionwhich is a decreasing fuzzy, which is a piecewise linear type membership function with some tolerance pi, then we prove that to solve the right-hand side coefficient constraint is equivalent to solve the problem with a constraint in the, with a, the, to, the constraint with tolerance in the resource.So the simple case study problem can be considered by assuming the membership function for each fuzzy inequality in this form. And given the tolerance level for those three constraints, 1.3, 1, and 1 respectively,we can find that the problem is equivalent to solve this one. not this one. As you can see, here is 8 plus 8 plus 1 multiply PI. If PI is 1.3, so 8 plus 1.3 is 9.3. And we have 1.3 alpha. We have minus 1.3 alpha. So we put 1 minus point alpha on the left side of the inequality. Therefore, the first inequality constraint, body constraint, become a regular inequality constraint after a transformation for alpha level cut. Similarly, the second constraint has 10 plus the tolerance 1 multiply 1, so it's become 11. And with the tolerance 1 multiply alpha, which is alpha. The third constraint with right hand side 16 plus the tolerance is 1, so we have 17. And similarly, the tolerance is 1, and so we have 1 alpha here. Therefore, to solve the fuzzy linear programming based on vertex non-symmetric model, which is equivalent to solve this traditional linear programming model by given an alpha. For different alpha, you can have different optimization problem. Therefore, it's clear that the solution of this fuzzy linear programming problem is still fuzzy, right? 就是你有给不同的 alpha 介于0到1之间，你给不同的 alpha值，你会得到不同的最佳解。所以它的解，那到底应该是哪一个？如果我只要一个解，而不是你给我不同的 alpha得到不同的解，好，比方说 alpha是0.9 得到解是这一组，的 alpha是0.8 得到解是这一组，那这样的解集合其实是一个还是一个模糊集合，是吧？所以我们一般在做决策的时候。 老板是看不懂模糊集合的，他只要你给我一个值，你告诉我 s 到底是多少，所以我们要做一个动作叫做解 defuzzification. Most decision maker doesn't like a fuzzy solution. Therefore, you have to defuzzify your solution, your fuzzy decision, and find out, give the decision maker an exactly solution. That's called defuzzification. Okay. For example, in the control fuzzy control inventory control example, we would ask you to decide what's the purchase amount. So the purchase amount after the fuzzy control rules would be a fuzzy purchase amount. How to find the exactly amount should be purchased? We don't want purchase amount which is fuzzy because we don't know. The decision maker might not understand fuzzy set theory. So don't give him the solution of in the fuzzy set form. So what exactly amount should be purchased? Then we have to talk about defuzzification. After you obtain a fuzzy set solution, fuzzy set decision, how to defuzzification, how to defuzzify it to find the exactly amount to be purchased. There are different defuzzification methods. Most people would like to use max membership principle. Or some use centroid method. A weighted average method. Different method is based on the application you have. For example, in the inventory control problem, if you have the fuzzy decision, fuzzy purchase amount looks like with a membership function looks like this, then what exactly amount should be purchased? If we choose max min rule, then that means we find the minimum value of maximum degree. In this case, the maximum degree is 0.5. From values between 125 to 225, all those purchase amount has the same the maximum membership degree. Therefore, we choose the minimal one. The minimal one is 125. So that's the value you would suggest the decision maker to make the purchase. 这个 diversification 的方法有很多，你如果最后算出来的模糊决策是一个模糊集合，是一个模糊集合，那到底要就是说这个模糊集合里面有这么多值，你到底要选谁呢？那我们一般都会想选那个 membership degree 最高的值，对不对？因为就感觉上它隶属函数值最高。那可是如果它今天是梯形的，就是符合这个 membership degree 是 0.5 的，以这个例子来讲就不止一个人，那我们会大中取小，就是保守的意思。好，我们会取那个最小的125。 OK, and sometimes people would like to find the maximum value of maximum degree, which is 225. So 这因人而异，有人喜欢大中取大，有人喜欢大中取小，就是看每个人做事的风格。好，那还有根据你这个问题嘛，有时候取小会比较好，老板会比较这个轻松，或取大老板会比较喜欢。 OK, some people likes to use the method to do diversification which called centroid rule. Centroid rule 叫做重心法，它也是就是你做出来这个 membership function 哦，它有点像几率的那种概念，就是它用那个平均值 the centroid method with a formulation which is a ratio in the numerator part which is the integration of your variable multiply the membership function and the denominator which is the integration of the only the membership function. So it's like kind of like the concept in the probability theory to find the average. So in the centroid, if you use centroid method, the centroid rule to make the decision, you will find the purchase amount is 175. If you have time, you go back, you can check that. Okay? 所以如果用 centroid rule, 你发现你找到的这个 purchase amount 是 175, 所以其实也蛮合理的，因为它是落在这个最高的 membership degree 值之间。 OK, so there are of course other methods for diversification. I think most common one we use is the first three one. OK, and here are some other methods, symmetric model for solving the fuzzy mathematical programming problem.We don't think we have enough time to show off them. So basically, that's what we introduce about how fuzzy set theory apply to some operation research, industrial engineering problem. That's what we have for today's lecture.I hope you enjoy it. Any question? Hello, 一竹在吗？
谢谢老师，然后那个叶老师他会讲一下话。喂？
喂
，Hello，
吴老师好。
好，谢谢吴老师的演讲。Thank you very much again for Professor Hu's talk.Hopefully all of you have learned what is the fuzzy set and how to apply it. Fuzzy set is one of branch in the SOC committee. By the way, next Friday is National Public Holiday and we have no class and no online lecture. And that's the end of today's class. So dismiss. By the way, please take care of yourself and enjoy the long weekend. We'll see you next time.
Thank you. See you.
Thank you again. Bye.
谢谢老师，谢谢教授。
好，谢谢你们。有任何问题，欢迎 email 给胡教授，或者 email 给我，或者助教。好，那我们就先下课吧，哦。
谢
谢，
谢
谢大家，谢谢。
好，
谢谢，哎，
谢
谢老师，
谢谢，
谢谢各位，谢谢，
周末愉快。
谢谢老师，谢谢。
好，谢谢各位。